Talking with Don Henderson today on the program. And, Don, I got to talk a little bit of sports, particularly up your way. I guess the fans up in, well, maybe not New York as much, but South Jersey and Philadelphia are very thrilled about the Flyers doing something only two other teams have ever done, right?
Yeah, you're exactly right. I think it was 39?
42 and 75. I remember the Islanders well doing it, yeah.
Yeah, but they were the only two teams that were down 3-0 and came back to win. And not only that, what made it even more dramatic, and I saw the game, fortunate enough to see the game on Friday night, and the Flyers were down. When I say I saw the game, I saw it on television. I wasn't up in Boston. and the Flyers were down 3-0 in the first in the first period, and everybody said, boy, oh boy, Katie barred the door. This thing's all over. And lo and behold, the Flyers scored a goal just before the end of the first period to make it 3-1, and then they came out and tied it at 3-3 and actually had a goal taken away. Sort of a not really a controversial call. I mean, they reviewed it. I don't know how controversial it was. But then on a controversial penalty, and, you know, it's a funny thing. I don't know how much they've covered it down there or how many people would remember, but Boston won a championship on too many men on the ice when Don Cherry was the coach of the Boston Bruins, and that's exactly what happened to Boston this time. They had too many men on the ice, and the Flyers got a penalty situation. They got a power play and scored the goal and won it 4-3. And as you point out, only two other teams in the history of the National Hockey League have ever come back from 3-0. And boy, oh boy, the city of Philadelphia just went absolutely bonkers.
And the Flyers really weren't one of the teams that people expected to make a good run this year. They're always thought to be in it, but never really a serious contender the last few years. But they got a shot now against Montreal.
Yeah, Doug, you know, the funny thing was that before the season started, they were touted as a strong possibility to be in the Stanley Cup Finals.
Is that right?
To
okay.
win it, but then they got—they just didn't play well all year.
Played terrible.
And they had a win. They had to get into the playoffs. You probably remember this. Maybe people wouldn't down in Florida, but they got in on the last day, the last game of the season.
Yeah.
And you know, nobody really expected them to even make the playoffs. So they won that last game, and lo and behold, they were the eighth seed, and here they are playing Montreal and. It should be a lot of fun. It should be a great series.
The Canadians have a hot goalie themselves, not expected to get this far either, so that should be a pretty good series in the East.
Yeah, in fact, you know, both goaltenders, although, as I said, the Flyers, when they dropped behind 3-0, I don't think anybody really expected to see the Flyers come back. And I mean, National, you know, it was funny because I was coming back from Philly, and John Sterling, who used to do the Islander games, who now is a Yankee broadcaster, he was on with Susan Waldman. I was listening to the game coming back, and John Sterling said, "Holy smokes! You know this isn't basketball. you don't come back in a National Hockey League from three down in a championship round." So I give him credit. It was a pretty funny comment.
And the other series will be Chicago and San Jose. So that's coming up. And talk a little bit about.
I don't think anybody's surprised about San Jose.
No, they're doing very well.
Yeah, the only way they're surprised about San Jose is that they folded every year once they got to the playoffs. They've had a very, very representative team for a few years, and they always get knocked out early in the playoffs. And this is the first year that they've carried off the regular season and carried it into the playoffs. So that ought to be a great series as well. And the other thing was, just a little bit to the south of us, I know you were watching the Preakness with great enthusiasm, and Baffett finally got a horse with a jockey that could win.
I didn't win much on that one, Don. I didn't expect first dude to be up there the whole race either.
Well, the change of jockeys going to Martin Garcia seems to have helped things, and he came out of a much better post position. He didn't get that one post position to get crammed in. And
yeah, looking at Lucky would talk one, yeah.
Yeah, and also the fact that Super Saver never really. Never really jumped out.
Never fired at all. No, that was surprising.
He was in second position, and until it got to the top of the stretch, and then fifth, and then of course wound up coming in eighth. But Super Saver just never. Burrell never really got a chance to do very much, and so Baffett, he's
tied with D. Wayne Lucas for most wins.
Five, I think that's what they have. But it was a fun race, and 80,000 people there was a great thing for the Preakness, great thing for Baltimore. And hopefully, you know, they'll be able to keep that track going. They're in real financial trouble, but hopefully somewhere along the line somebody's going to jump in and help them out.
Good crowd over at the Kennel Club yesterday. Went over there to place a couple of dollars down, and it always does a good business over there on the Preakness Day. But didn't come away with too much money.
The other thing that you told me that I didn't know this morning was that Pat Burrell's been, there was a lot of conversation about that might happen before I left Sarasota. But you told me, you know, that the Rays finally decided to cut the links with Pat, and he had a pretty hefty contract, as you and I talked about. How much of that is still owed to him, I don't know, but that's an interesting move by the Rays.
Yeah, designated for assignment is always the term they use. Basically means we're getting rid of you, right?
Yeah, and the only thing is you get a nice parachute going out.
They have to pay you.
Excuse me,
baseball,
I think he signed an $8 million contract or $9 million contract going in, so
yeah.
I'm sure he has, you know, at least half of that left for this year, so... if he doesn't catch on with somebody else, he's at least going to go out with a golden parachute of $4 or $5 million. So.
Yeah, I'm sure somebody will give him a shot later this year.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. He's only, what, 32, 33. It's not like he's end of the rope.
No.
But
no,
he just never took off with the Rays for some reason. He had great years with the Phillies, as you know, up there, but for some reason didn't work down here.
No, it was a funny thing. It was you and I talked about it. I don't know if we talked about it on the air, but he was always a very controversial figure with Larry Bowen. Larry thought he had all kinds of talent, thought he was an outstanding player, but wouldn't make adjustments, just wouldn't change the way he approached hitting. And Larry said until he does that, until he decides that, you know, he's not going to pull every ball to the left field stands, that he's got to hit the ball to right center, and he's got to you know, move the ball around the field and then make the pitchers come inside to him and then take advantage of it. But he never did that. He just continually tried to hit the ball to left field, continually tried to hit home runs, and they just throw him that pitch low and away, and goodbye, Pat Burrell. He just couldn't, you know, he was hitting, like, I guess about .220 when I left. I don't know where he was.
About the same, yeah. Well, Don, always great to catch up with you. You enjoying the Jersey Shore yet?
Everything's been great. Finally got the house opened up, and everything seems to be going along smoothly, and miss that Sarasota atmosphere, but I'll be back soon.
We'll keep an eye on your place down here for you. Make sure nobody bothers
it. Enjoy, and I'll get a chance to talk to you sometime during the week.
Great. We'll talk to you next show, too, Don. Thanks for being with us.
Anytime you say.